The country's digitalization push, as well as the Philippines' goal of attaining food and energy security. The Foreign Affairs Department says those are among the issues that President Marcos will emphasize as he engages in talks with various leaders during the 43rd Association of Southeast Asian Nations Summit in Indonesia next week. It will be the second ASEAN summit this year.
Overall, the president is expected to attend 13 leaders-level engagements, 12 of them summit sessions with other leaders. In these engagements, the president will continue to uphold and promote Philippine interests in ASEAN. He will highlight our advocacies in strengthening food and energy security, harnessing the potential of the digital and creative industries and MSMEs, and addressing the impacts of climate change, among others.
The DFA also says the formulation of the code of conduct in the disputed waters may, quote, take a little bit longer due to differences of claimant countries. The COC is envisioned to upgrade the 2002 Declaration on the Conduct of Parties in the South China Sea by having a pact to manage tensions in the waters where different parties have separate claims. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. approves imposing price ceilings on rice nationwide to stabilize prices and supply. Now, under Executive Order 39, the mandated price ceiling for regular milled rice is 41 pesos per kilogram, while the price cap for well-milled rice is at 45 pesos. The order stems from the recommendation of the Agriculture and Trade Department following what Malacañang described as the alarming increase in retail prices in the market. The agencies also reported alleged illegal price manipulation and hoarding by traders as well as industry cartels. Now, speaking of inflationary pressures, consumers woke up to higher LPG prices Friday. Auto LPG prices went up by 3 pesos and 70 centavos per liter, while cooking gas prices got an increase of more than 6 pesos per kilogram.
Historical naman talaga na pagdating ng ganitong mga buwan, stockpiling ng mga bansang may winter season, and the demand is high in the world market, kaya talagang sumipa ang LPG.
Pump prices are also expected to rise for a ninth straight week next week, with Jetty Petroleum President Leo Belia citing tightness in supply. The Philippine Senate will approve a proposed 150 peso across-the-board wage increase by year-end. That promise coming from Senate President Juan Miguel Zubiri. He says the proposed wage hike will also cover those who earn above the minimum wage. For Senate Minority or Majority Leader Joel Villanueva, it's about time the Philippines provides its workforce with a living wage.
In the last hearing of the Committee on Labor, while it was said that poverty threshold is being considered, if you look at the data, 14 out of the 17 regions are below poverty threshold for a family of five. So you can see the difference, and that is why we are very passionate in pushing for the living wage.
In other news, the Philippine government's budget deficit saw a 45% decrease in July. Data from the Treasury Bureau show the deficit was at 47.8 billion pesos. That's lower than last year's 86.8 billion. This comes as the growth in government income outpaced that of spending during that month. As of end July, the national government's budget gap stands at nearly 600 billion pesos, which is about 21% lower than last year's shortfall. Philippine inflation seen to rise for the first time in 7 months. According to the Philippine Central Bank, the August Consumer Price Index could settle between 4.8% and 5.6%. That's higher than last month's 4.7% reading. Now, the BSP cites higher prices of rice and other agriculture commodities due to the recent string of typhoons. It also points to the rise in fuel prices and the weakening of the Philippine peso. Philippine businesses urged to bring more local brands abroad. Algeria Bing Sibal Limhoco, known as the mother of Philippine franchising, says the move could boost economic growth and support job creation and generation. She urges government to include a proposal in the Philippine Export Development Plan, which was approved by President Marcos Jr. back in June, to boost the country's lagging export sector.
Our Filipino brands have existed well overseas. When we export our brands, we are able to help not only in the products, but also they would need also our Filipino talents there.
Aboitiz Power launches its e-vehicle fleet program in line with government's move to boost the EV industry. Aboitiz Power says the vehicles will be deployed to three key cities where its distribution utilities are located.
Nakikita na mga trucks na the electric vehicle na pwedeng na reliable na pwedeng namin gamitin sa field, no? Once it's available, then we will consider. We want to transform energy for a better world. I think by introducing electric vehicles into our fleet with zero carbon emissions, I think that's doing the right thing.
And it isn't just Aboitiz Power. Water concessionaires Maynilad and Manila Water have also purchased e-vehicles. Maynilad targets to electrify half of its fleet by 2037. Under government's Electric Vehicle Industry Development Act, or EVIDA, at least 5% of the fleets of industrial and commercial companies must comprise of EVs. At least one business group believes the Philippines could be a first world country by 2040. Jackie Pascual tells us the reason for the upbeat outlook.
The Philippines may become a first world economy by 2040. That's according to the Philippine Chamber of Commerce and Industry. PCCI believes the country could reach an upper middle income status before President Marcos steps down.
Can be done. It's doable. And with the many blessings of our country that I cited, like first in marine biodiversity, sailors, nurses, call centers, second in geothermal, etc., what I mentioned a while ago, we have the ingredients of success.
But at least one business leader admits there are still government policies and other issues that may cause foreign investors to think twice.
With regard to foreign investors, cost of power, ease of doing business, and they want clearer policies and programs of government. That's why some of the potential foreign investors, they go to Vietnam.
Sergio Ortiz Luis, who leads several business organizations, agrees, adding that the economy may only hit the low end of the GDP target this year.
I think we have to adjust our, I think we are looking at the high end. I think we should be looking at the lower end now of the projection. We're looking at 6% siguro, baka even a little less, you know. And I think that will not only be true for this year, but maybe in the medium term or so, maybe next year, I don't know.
He adds that the Philippines should remain a friend to all amid the territorial dispute with China, which is slowly affecting growth.
Marami rin sa mga sources natin na supply, natatakot sa atin mag-supply ngayon. Marami rin sa investment na nagtatanong sa atin, dami dumarating dito eh. Ayaw na, hindi na sila.
PCCI President George Barcelon also wants to see improvements in various sectors for the country to achieve sustainable growth. Among the areas for improvement are education and skills upgrading, infrastructure, and agriculture, among others. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
The White House pressing lawmakers to pass a short-term funding measure to avoid a government shutdown by the end of this month. This as negotiations for longer-term appropriations bills remain in a deadlock. Funding for the federal government's set to run out on September 30, and with weeks to go until that deadline, the Republican-led House of Representatives has only passed one of 12 bills needed to keep government operations running. Climate change and El Niño-induced drought threatens shipping on the Panama Canal. As this report tells us, authorities have imposed restrictions on the vital waterway, which is responsible for moving 40% of the world's cargo ship traffic.
A crucial waterway for trade, the Panama Canal links the Atlantic and Pacific Oceans. But Panamanian officials say the two main freshwater reservoirs that feed the canal are well below optimum level. That's due to the increasing effects of climate change and drought-caused El Niño, a weather phenomenon in the Pacific Ocean that has reduced normal rainy season rainfall. While the canal remains functional, the daily transit capacity has been lowered from 38 vessels to 32. Administrators have also imposed weight restrictions and encouraged vessel owners to reserve a crossing time to avoid delays.
We are continually notifying our customers to reserve their slots or participate in auctions so they don't have to wait in transit. And they are aware the canal capacity have been reduced by 6 to 7 ships per day.
The low water levels and conservation measures have produced a backlog. There are currently more than 100 ships waiting to cross the Panama Canal. The United States is the canal's main partner and client, followed by China, Japan, and Chile. Serving as a shortcut between Asia and the eastern United States, the canal plays a pivotal role in global trade. Panamanian economist Carlos Arauz is worried delays and restrictions will hurt an already strained supply chain.
During the pandemic, freight rates shot up by almost 70%. In other words, everything was costing 70% more. These freight rates had been adjusting to pre-pandemic levels. The current situation is making them shoot up again. Not to pandemic levels, but prices could be impacted between 12 and 18%.
The Panama Canal Authority, the government agency responsible for overseeing canal operation and management, has said the weight and transit restrictions will remain in place at least for the next 10 months. Canal operators worry the already low rain and canal water levels will get worse when Panama's dry season starts in December. And long-range predictions suggest next year's rainy season could also bring a lower than normal rainfall. For Oscar Zulbarán in Panama City, Veronica Villafañe, VOA News.
A ride-hailing firm Uber launches an electric motorbike service in Kenya. It's first in Africa as the company seeks to market its global platform emissions-free by 2040. Dubbed Electric Boda, in a nod to the Swahili term for motorbike taxis, Uber's new green product will comprise 3,000 bikes with 6 months or within 6 months or just under a fifth of its fleet. Now, the company says drivers will see up to a 35% drop in operating costs, which will translate to a 15 to 20% savings for users. Now, Kenya, which operates more than 90% of its power from renewable sources, has been positioning itself as a hub to lead Africa's shift to greener transport.